All right, so my name's James Taylor. I first just want to thank the Linux Foundation and all the sponsors for putting on this great event. And of course, ASF for all the great work that you guys are doing. One small request, though, if the next conference could be in Phoenix, so I can give the Phoenix talk in Phoenix, I think that would be really cool. Okay, a little bit about me. Before I get started on my talk, I'm an engineer at Salesforce. I've worked at Salesforce for about 5.5 years. A little bit about Phoenix and the history of Phoenix. I started that about 3.5 years ago as an internal project at Salesforce. And we pretty quickly realized that it was going to be generally useful. So we open sourced it on GitHub about 1.5 years back. And then about 4 months ago, we kind of graduated to become an incubator project on Apache, so we're pretty excited about that. Before that, I was at BEA Systems working on things like federated query engine and WebLogic event server, where I did a kind of a complex event processing system that was SQL-based as well. So I've done very SQL-ish things in my career. Okay, as far as what I want to cover, I want to answer two basic questions. I want to tell you what Phoenix is, and I want to tell you why it's so fast. And then I want to talk a little bit about some new features that we've introduced in our 3.0 and our 4.0 release that allows HBase to scale in an entirely new dimension. And then I'll touch on our roadmap and leave a little time for Q&A. Okay, so what is Apache Phoenix? So there's really four kind of attributes that really define what Phoenix is. The first one is it takes HBase, which I assume you guys are familiar with. It's just short poll. Who uses HBase here? Okay, a number of people, that's good. So Phoenix takes HBase and it turns it into a SQL database. HBase is really nothing more than a byte store. It's not meant to be a query engine. That's where Phoenix comes in. So Phoenix provides a query parser, a compiler, an execution engine, an optimizer. And it also manages your metadata. So it manages your tables and your columns, your constraints, indexes, sequences, views. But from your point of view, it's nothing more than a JDBC driver. So you use it like you do any other JDBC driver. We support all the standard JDBC interfaces as well as the optional metadata APIs as well. And Phoenix is only for HBase data. So we're not trying to be a general kind of SQL over Hadoop solution. We're targeting specifically HBase data. So number two, Phoenix is the fastest way to access your HBase data. Because we're targeting only HBase, we do a lot of specific pushdowns into HBase that hides the complexity of HBase itself. So it simplifies your life. So essentially what we do is we take your SQL query and we compile it down to native HBase client API calls. There's no MapReduce in Phoenix at all, so that's a big part of what allows us to support kind of interactive, low latency web type applications. So we take those scans that we compile down to and we execute those in parallel on the client. So how fast is Phoenix? So here's just a point of reference, right? Simple query selecting three rows among, say, a little over 100 million rows and selecting those by the PK. So Phoenix will do that in 4/100ths of a second, so 40 milliseconds. Stinger, the latest version of Hive, does that in 280 seconds. So 7,000 times faster. So I can't even graph this. I mean, I tried to graph it, but it just looks like Phoenix is the x-axis, because that 40 milliseconds is a constant time for this query. Whereas in Stinger, as your data grows, this 280 seconds will grow linearly with the size of your data. So that gives you an idea of the performance difference that you'll see. Okay, number three, Phoenix is lightweight. There's no additional servers that you set up to use Phoenix. And it's 100% Java. It's very simple to install. All you do is copy a jar into your HBase lib directory and all your region servers. Or you can use a distribution that already bundles Phoenix. For example, the next Hortonworks distribution is going to bundle the 4.0 version of Phoenix, so you won't have to do any installation in that case. Phoenix is also available on Amazon EMR, so there's no setup required if you use Amazon Web Services. Okay, just to give you a high-level picture of where Phoenix fits in here, so here's your standard HBase cluster architecture with your HBase client on the upper left-hand corner. Your standard ZooKeeper and HMaster, then your region servers that you access your data through, and of course at the lowest levels is HDFS. So where does Phoenix fit in here? Well, Phoenix fits on top of the HBase client, so it hides the HBase client APIs, and it essentially replaces those APIs with a JDBC driver. And then on the server side, Phoenix is co-resident with the region servers. So we take advantage of some very nifty HBase hooks called custom filters and coprocessors, where we can actually hook in code and intercept scans and execute parts of those scans more efficiently depending on your query. So that gives you an idea of where Phoenix fits in. Okay, number four is Apache Phoenix is integration friendly. So we are really kind of becoming part of the whole Apache ecosystem. We have integration that let you read and write through Pig, for example. We have integration with Flume if you're doing kind of log processing. We have kind of work in progress on integrating with Scoop, so you can directly import your relational databases into HBase and query them directly with Phoenix. And finally, we can map to existing base table that you've created outside of Phoenix. Then what you can do is you can issue a create table statement in Phoenix to map to that table, and you can immediately start to query that table. There are some restrictions of when that's possible and when that isn't possible, depending on your schema. And I could talk about that a little bit later. Okay, so just to review, four things that Apache Phoenix is. Turns HBase into a SQL database. It's the fastest way to access your HBase data. It's lightweight and it's integration friendly. All right, why is Phoenix fast? So I'm going to go through four reasons here about why Phoenix is fast. So one is HBase itself. So HBase is very fast, but it's also very dumb. But it's dumb on purpose. They want to be a byte store. They don't want to be a query engine. So that's where Phoenix fits in. So next, the Phoenix data model. So of those of you who use HBase, I'm just curious, who puts more than one piece of information in the row key for your HBase tables? So pretty much everybody. I mean, it's pretty much standard practice. So Phoenix supports that in its data model by letting you define a composite primary key, where you list more than one column that's part of your row key. Our serialization format in Phoenix, The binary data sorts according to the natural order of your data. So that helps when you do, for example, an order by, because your rows will already be sorted in the natural order according to your column, so we don't have to resort it, which is a very expensive operation. Number three is the parallelization that we do. So I mentioned that before. So we take your query and we chunk it up into multiple scans and we run all those scans in parallel. HBase out of the box, it's client API. When you issue a scan, it does it serially, region by region by region. And number four is the pushdown we do. So again, we're specific to HBase, so we do a lot of very specific pushdown into HBase and use all these esoteric features that you may have never heard of, and maybe you're not sure which version it works with, which version it doesn't work with. So Phoenix manages all that for you. For example, there's a seek next hint that we use in filters. There's essential column families that you may or may not know about that make it more efficient to filter on a small piece of data but return a large piece of data. There's reverse scans that we take advantage of, and there's seeking to the next column versus just doing a next. And all these details that can make a huge difference in your performance, Phoenix manages automatically. So what I want to do next, I want to show you our data model and give you an idea of how our data model maps to the HBase data model. So first off, I'm just going to do a little review of the HBase data model. So the basic building block in HBase is a table. A table is composed of multiple column families, and those column families contain column qualifiers. And then you have your actual data composed of key values. Part of that key value is your row key. And you have, of course, multiple rows with different row keys. And HBase data model, it's really only storing those key values for you. So it's a sparse data model. And then the final dimension in HBase is the time dimension. So you'll have multiple versions with the same row key that overlay each other with different timestamps. So that's kind of a picture of the HBase data model. Now, how does Phoenix map to this? Well, a Phoenix table maps one-to-one with an HBase table. Simple. We have two types of columns in Phoenix. We have key value columns and columns that are part of the primary key. So key value columns map to column qualifiers. So when you issue a DDL statement in Phoenix, you're declaring what possible column qualifiers a table can contain. We do have another mechanism that lets you do kind of a schema on write and a schema on read. So if you can't specify column qualifiers up front, we do let you specify that at query time or at upsert time as well. Okay, and then the primary key constraint is what defines the structure of your row key. So those columns will essentially be concatenated to form your row key in HBase. So I'll run through an example next. So let's say you have a server metrics table that you want to define. And you've got the host and the date, which is going to be your primary key. So, and then you've got your key values, which are the metrics that you want to collect for your server metrics table. So putting those things together, this is what the DDL statement would look like in Phoenix. It's standard SQL. You see the primary key defined as a composite primary key of host together with date. And then your other columns, which aren't part of your primary key, are your key value columns. And those are going to be stored in HBase's key values. Okay, so here's an example, same example, but with the data now. Okay, so here's 10 or so rows with the host and the date concatenated together. That will be your the bytes of your row key. And then these metric values will be the values of your key value. So that gives you an idea of what the data model looks like. Now, the next thing I want to do is I want to walk through a couple of examples of the pushdown we do. Now, I'm going to use this query that I put up here, which is a query over the server metrics table that's going to look, say, at the last 7 days' worth of data. And it's going to filter on only the hosts that begin with SF. say you only want to look at hosts that are resident in San Francisco, for example. And we're going to group by host, and we're going to calculate an average response time across all your hosts. Okay, so now I'm going to walk through four examples of the pushdown that we do. The first is our skip scan filter. So skip scan filter works on when you're filtering on your row key columns. So in this case, you're filtering on both the date and the host, which is your composite primary key. So our query engine will pick up on that and we'll use the skip scan. And let's say you've got four regions worth of data in your server metrics table. Okay, so the first thing that Phoenix is going to do is it's going to issue parallel scans based on your region boundaries from the client side. Next, it's going to push the range information from your query through our skip scan filter, and then on the server side, it's going to use that to drive skipping through your primary, through your server metrics table. And it's leveraging a feature in HBase where you can seek to a next key. So basically, on the server side, each region will be skipping through parts of the data that aren't relevant based on your query, and then we'll include parts of the data, and then we'll skip and include, and so on, until finally we've exhausted all the ranges that we've gleaned from your where clause. And then we'll do further downstream processing on what gets returned through that filter. Okay, so same query, now we're gonna do the group by part of it. Okay, so how does Phoenix do the group by? Again, we rely on a coprocessor that we've written to do aggregation. So in this case, the raw data that gets passed through that skip scan filter will be further condensed and aggregated down depending on what your group by key is. So in this case, you're grouping by host. So it'll only return the aggregate values for your distinct hosts that it sees. So in this case, it's three rows. So that's gonna, what that's gonna help with is that two things that's gonna help with is it's gonna conserve your network bandwidth. So rather than returning all of the rows back to the client and doing the aggregation on the client side, we're doing aggregation on the server side. And the second way that's going to help is that we're actually running that scan on the server side where the data lives as opposed to on the client side. So you're going to get two big performance boosts based on that. Okay, so that's aggregation. Next, I want to talk about top-end type queries. Now, top-end queries are where you want to find the top-end values. So the query is written with an order by and a limit, where the limit defines how many values you want to see, and the order by defines which values you want to see. So in this particular query, you're going to be finding the five largest GC times. So how does Phoenix push this query down? Well, what we do is we do the same skip scan filtering that I mentioned before, but then instead of the aggregate coprocessor kicking in, our top-end coprocessor kicks in. And each scan that occurs for each region will hold on to the top five values that it sees. So then at the end of the day, each scan will return five rows, and then the client will do a final merge sort between those 15 values and return back the five values to you. So this is going to be much more efficient than what other products do, which might be to sort your entire data set. If it's a billion rows, that's going to take an awfully long time to sort a billion rows. Okay, next I just want to touch a little bit on secondary indexes, because that's a feature that we've had since our 2.0 release. I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but I want to mention that, let's say, instead of doing a top... The top end is fast, but we still have to make a pass through the data. And so let's say you've added a secondary index to index the GC time and the date. So the way this works in Phoenix is your index will be represented with a completely different HBase table. So now you'll have your regular server metrics table and your server metrics index table. And in the index table, the row key structure will be different. The row key structure will be determined by the columns that you're indexing. So in this case, leading with GC time, followed by date. And then your key value columns will be whatever additional columns that you've included. So now, what Phoenix will do is anytime you'll issue the same query that you did before, so your query doesn't change, but under the covers, what Phoenix is going to do, it's going to rewrite that query to query the index table instead of the data table, because what Phoenix does is it maintains the index and the data table in sync between, based on some coprocessors we've written that handle the puts that you do. So one important point to note is that your index is only going to be used if all of the columns that you reference in your query exist in that index, because we currently don't keep any stats. So Phoenix doesn't know if it's going to be more efficient to take the index rows and join back to the data table to get additional columns. So it simply won't use the index if you're referencing a column that doesn't exist. So that's where the including the response time, like I showed before, is important, because if your query references response time, you're going to want to include that in your index. So we will introduce stats collection in our next version of Phoenix. And we'll also going to be including some local indexing, which is a feature I'll talk about a little bit later. That's something that some folks at Huawei are working on called H-Index, and I encourage you to go to the next talk, which is going to talk about that, and that's pretty exciting technology. So they volunteered to contribute that to Phoenix soon. So, okay, so the last pushdown I want to talk about is how we handle a join. So we have a kind of a broadcast hash join mechanism. So in this case, let's say you're taking your server metrics table and you're joining that with an auxiliary table that may have more information about your host. So what Phoenix is going to do in this case, it's going to kind of tease apart the left-hand side of your query from the right-hand side of your query. So in this case, I'm showing you highlighted all the parts in the query that reference anything in the server metrics table. And here's all the stuff that's referenced in the right-hand side table or the host info table. So Phoenix will tease those two apart, and now it has a left-hand side query and a right-hand side query. So what it's going to do is it's going to issue that right-hand side query, and it's going to take all the results from that query, and it's going to send it to each region server, where it'll be cached while the left-hand side query is actually executed. And then we have a join coprocessor that will actually take the, it'll do a kind of a hash map lookup in your right-hand side cached table against the rows coming through on your left-hand side, and then it'll join those two together and return the joined results as the results of your query. So that's essentially how we implement our broadcast hash join. Okay, so now I want to shift away from talking about why Phoenix is so fast and talk about how it can and help HBase scale. So the Phoenix team and the HBase team, we have a really great working relationship. We're very symbiotic. Half of the Phoenix committers are also HBase committers, and two-thirds of our mentors are actually PMC members of HBase. So that's really nice. So this new feature that we introduced in Phoenix 3.0 and 4.0 allows multiple Phoenix tables to all reside in the same HBase table. So I'm just curious, folks who are using HBase, in your application, do you have, say, more than 10 HBase tables? Does anybody have more than 10 HBase tables? Okay, a couple people. Anybody have more than 50 HBase tables? Okay, interesting. How many? Just curious. Okay, so as you increase the number of tables in HBase, it's not going to scale beyond a certain point. So we introduced this capability to define views. So views is a standard kind of SQL paradigm, but when you define a view in Phoenix, what you're doing is you're telling Phoenix that you want that view to basically be a segment of a physical HBase table. So I'll show you a picture that should make that a little bit more clear. So the reason HBase prefers to have a few very big tables rather than lots of small, large, sorry, it prefers to have a few big tables that are rather than a large number of small tables. And the reason for that is HBase is consuming resources for every column family, for every region, for every table, and it will run out of resources. Memstore and the wall just won't scale beyond a certain point. Okay, so here's an example of defining a view. So a good use case for this is events. So let's say you create an event table in Phoenix. So remember, a Phoenix table maps one-to-one with an HBase table. And you've got a composite row key of your event type plus your event ID. And then you've got key value columns for the date of when that event occurred and maybe who created that event. And then when you create a view of that table, it's, again, standard SQL syntax to create a view. You include a where clause there that identifies a segment of that table. So here's graphically kind of what you'll see, right? Say you've created four events for different types of things like a web event, a phone event, a mobile event, and a chat event. So essentially what you've done is you've segmented your table. Now you'll have one HBase table, an event table, and you'll have four views in this case. So you may say, well, big deal, HBase is fine having four HBase tables, but let me add another dimension here. Let's say you've got a multi-tenant situation where you want to create different event tables for different users or organizations that are using your system. So Phoenix now supports this, and the way you do this is you tack on a multi-tenant equals true property onto your DDL statement. And then you add or insert your first column to identify your tenant. Okay, so now your view that you created looks exactly the same, but in this case, when you connect through JDBC, you specify some additional information if you want a tenant-specific connection. So you identify the tenant, and that tenant ID, me, is the value of that tenant ID column for that particular tenant, right? And then what we allow you to do is create a view on top of that view, which further segments your data. So this is a tenant-specific view. So you can add columns here as well. So different tenants, their schemas can evolve independent of each other, essentially. So now if you look at how this table is segmented, it's segmented first by tenant ID. So for example, in the Salesforce case, we might have hundreds of thousands of tenants all residing in the same HBase table, each owning their own segment of that table. And then when you superimpose the other views that I mentioned before, then now you've got, for each of those tenant segments, you've got further subdivision based on the where clause of your views. So now you've got potentially 400,000 virtual tables that are all co-resident in the same HBase table. So there's no way you could have a system like this in stock HBase. It just wouldn't scale. Okay, so there are some restrictions of what you can and can't do in multi-tenant tables. So one being that the primary key constraint cannot change in your view. So your primary key from your base table is going to be your primary key of your views as well. But the way we get around that for query performance is we allow you to define an index for a primary, for a multi-tenant table or for a view. And so in that case, you'll have, instead of one physical HBase table, you'll have two physical HBase tables, one to store your data and one to store all your indexes. And one thing to note is when you connect through a tenant-specific connection, we're automatically restricting the data that that tenant can see to only that segment of the table that they kind of own, basically. If you do a describe on your view, you'll see only your columns, whereas if you connect as another tenant, that tenant will see their columns. Certain DDL operations are going to be restricted on views and on the base table as well. So once you create views for a base table, we no longer allow you to alter the base table. You can drop and add columns in your view, but you can't drop columns that are referenced in your where clause. Okay, so next I just want to touch on a few items in our roadmap, and then I'm going to open it up for questions. So one thing we're working on are derived or nested tables. This is your standard SQL syntax that allows you to do a select, and then in the from clause, you have another nested select. That's probably the biggest missing SQL feature that we don't currently support. So we're going to include that in our next release. Another item we're going to include, this is something that folks from Huawei are interested in contributing, is local indexing. This is really interesting technology that essentially has your data and your table data and your index data will be co-resident on the same region server. So it's a very good model for supporting multiple or lots of indexes on a given table, because you don't take a hit at write time when you index in this manner. Another thing we're going to add is more strategies for joins. For example, sometimes doing a hash join is not an option because you have two tables where maybe you're not filtering that much to the point where a hash join is going to be feasible. So we'll support many-to-many joins, and we'll also optimize certain joins where you're joining on the primary key. There's a lot of optimizations we can do there. We're going to start down the path of having a cost-based query optimizer. And the first step will be to collect stats. And the way we'll collect stats, we'll piggyback on compaction in HBase. So there won't be any additional overhead to collect these stats. And then we'll use these stats under the covers to drive optimizer decisions. So that's going to be an interesting area. We would like to add support for the OLAP extensions in SQL. This has to do with defining windows and partition bys and ranking and things like that. And it's very good for analytic type use cases. So that's on our roadmap. And then a final thing on our roadmap is support for transactions. Several private companies have implemented transactions through snapshot isolation, and we would like to do the same. They've actually done that without making any changes to stock HBase. So it is very, very possible to do that. So that gives you kind of an idea of where we're headed, and we'd love to get contributions from all of you, of course. So if you're interested, just ping us on the dev list. So that's it. Thank you very much. I'd like to open it up for questions or comments that you may have. Thanks.
Are there plans to support more complicated elements in the cells, so like a Avro object or a protobuf or something like that being stored in the cell as opposed to like a string or integer or the kind of primitives?
Yeah, that is something that's on our roadmap as well. The idea there is to support structs. Like a lot of SQL dialects have this concept of creating a kind of an object or a struct. And we see that as a way of supporting that kind of thing.
Okay.
So you mentioned that you store index in a separate table, right? So how do you manage to keep it in sync, like with original data?
So we have two modes for our global index support currently. We have one mode where you declare up front that your table is kind of write once, append only, right? And so that's a common scenario where maybe you're doing log processing and it's ever increasing data, right? So in that case, we don't do any index maintenance because we don't need to, right? Because your rows are never changing. The other type of index and the kind of default kind of index that gets created, we have a coprocessor that captures your puts and takes your puts you're doing and creates the index row based on your puts in your data table, essentially.
But what if it fails in the middle? I mean, you do put in index table and then don't do it in original table or vice versa, what happens?
So what if it fails? So that's a good question. So we have two failure policies, if you will. Out of the box, what we'll do is, because remember, to update the index, potentially you're writing from one region server to another region server, right? So in our default behavior is to disable the index if that put to the other region server fails, right? And then it's up to you to kind of rebuild that index, or maybe you have an alert for that case, right? The other case, and this is work that one of our committers, Jesse Yates, does, is to kill the region server, right? Because if you're on a region server and you can't reach the other region server, then you may be in trouble. Your cluster may be in a bad state. So by killing the region server, Jesse has this nice scheme of, in the write-ahead log, we actually write both the data for the table as well as the data for the index. So when the server comes back up, we'll replay the wall and replay the data and the index edits so that everything stays in sync.
So we compared its performance with Hive. So what Hive internally does is it writes MapReduce. How it works? How Phoenix works internally?
I'm sorry, I missed the last part of your question.
So Hive writes MapReduce to fetch data, right?
Right.
So how Phoenix work internally?
How does Phoenix work internally?
Yeah. Does it write MapReduce or?
No, there's no MapReduce. So Phoenix, essentially, it's a query engine, right? So we, under the covers, we take your query and we compile it down to native HBase calls. So we take your query and turn it into HBase scans, essentially. And then we do it in parallel, and then the client will merge the results we get back from all of those scans, and we'll hand back the results to you.
Okay, thank you.
So there is a project called Spark, and they have a part of the project is called Shark. So they have a kind of a solution, is like Hive plus Shark, to do like in-memory super fast search. So what's the difference between like the, so what's the advantage of using Phoenix above the Shark?
Sure. The advantage would be when your table gets big enough, right? Because remember, this is big data we're talking about, and you can no longer be memory resident for Shark or Spark to do its thing, right? So that's gonna be one big advantage. So we've done performance tests, and those are very good products. But at the end of the day, if your data gets too big, performance just drops off a cliff, you know? So Phoenix, you're gonna see much steadier performance. You're gonna have secondary indexes, because remember, Phoenix is not just a query engine, it's managing DDL and DML and secondary indexes and multi-tenancy and things like that that aren't going to be handled by other products, including Spark and Shark and Hive.
You said you use coprocessors and coprocessor-like plugin for doing things like the hash joins and everything like that.
Right.
If we were to agree that abstraction makes programming easier but performance harder, have you run into any issues with the coprocessor mechanism where it doesn't quite support what you need or it doesn't give you the performance you need? And how have you been able to work around those?
It's interesting. Coprocessors, it's almost the reverse. Like, coprocessors let you do anything. It's almost scary. To the point where we've had people want to have support for UDFs, right? So that's an interesting use case, right? And we could support UDFs because HBase does allow you to dynamically load a jar where potentially you've defined a UDF. But now, kind of the downside of coprocessors is that you're actually running co-resident with the region server, right? So if you do something funky in your UDF, you could bring down that whole region server, right? So it's a little bit, I think, like, HBase and may evolve to have two separate kinds of coprocessors, one that lets you do anything you want that's co-resident in the region server, and a second one that's kind of more sandboxed, right? And maybe a pared-down API. So that's kind of, you know, I'm kind of making this up because I'm not an HBase committer, but I can see that they'll have more of that kind of model. Yeah. Then, and one other note in terms of performance, I think for HBase, I think scan performance still has a lot of room to improve. I mean, a raw scan, it's fast, it's good, but it doesn't compare to what you can do like with a columnar store representation, right? And I think where HBase can help is having different kind of block encoding formats that are more kind of columnar store-like, and I think that'll improve performance for analytic use cases in particular.
Hi. Is there a reason why this wasn't done as part of the Hive project? Because Hive itself deals with things like storing metadata and so on. You might well have piggybacked on that, so there's probably a reason why you didn't.
Yeah, a few reasons. The H catalog is fairly restrictive in the type of metadata that you can capture. For example, you can't have a composite row key definition. You can't indicate if a column is null or not null. The former is the biggest one, right? Our skip scan filter, that's where you get a lot of performance benefit by really leveraging HBase. And that's why you see that, you know, 7,000 times faster performance from Phoenix versus Hive. So I think if you try to fit in to that Hive metadata model, it's just too restricting and you can't get the performance that you really need.
One of the things you talked about was the tenants evolving their schema over time. Can you give an example of like where that's you've used that? And then kind of the question is, outside of querying these tables, you still won't be able to run MapReduce against it. So what, if you evolving schema at various sections of the table, how does that affect or play into being able to MapReduce it?
Yeah,
afterwards?
That's a good question. So I can tell you about our use case at Salesforce for these multi-tenant tables. So Salesforce has a platform, right? I don't know if you guys know anything about the Salesforce platform and our APIs, but you know, we have more than 100,000 customers, and we allow a customer or an organization to create a custom object. So you've got 100,000 customers all creating multiple custom objects that are completely different than each other, right? Because they're each writing their own application. So we're going to leverage multi-tenancy for that exact use case, right? So under the covers, a custom object in Salesforce will map to a multi-tenant table in Phoenix. And as a customer adds more columns, they'll be evolving and adding columns to their tenant-specific view, which are independent from all the other tenant-specific views, right? And then our query language in Salesforce is called SQL, and it looks a lot like SQL. And we already have a mechanism that takes SQL and turns it into SQL so you can just run it. So that's kind of our use case. And the obvious reason is we don't want to have to tell a customer, no, we can't handle your use case of, you know, 10 billion rows because we just can't scale to that. We don't want to, we want to not be have to say no, right? So that's the rationale. As far as MapReduce, you know, at the end of the day, these are just key values in a table, right? If the MapReduce can understand that your leading column is your tenant ID, and all the other key values are just key value columns. I mean, there's no reason why even you, with your slice of your HBase table, couldn't write a MapReduce job knowing, I mean, you know, of course, the key values that are part of that segment of that table. So you could write a MapReduce job that would operate only on your segment.
What if you
want
to do the whole thing across multiple
tenants? That's fine too. So then instead of coming in on a tenant-specific connection, you come in on a regular global connection. And then you can run MapReduce kind of across the board. It may become a little more difficult to you know which key values which tenant has, right? So that could be challenging, but all that metadata is accessible, so it would be feasible to write MapReduce even in that case.
How is it accessible? Is it you access like a RDBMS or something, or is it a different HBase table with all the metadata stored in it? Or
under the covers, it's a different HBase table. We have a system catalog table that we manage internally as another HBase table. So, and remember, like at the, I'm not sure how MapReduce jives with like JDBC, but if you could access JDBC through MapReduce, then you can use our the regular JDBC metadata APIs to query the metadata, right, for a particular tenant. Okay. And you could, I kind of see it more as a generating MapReduce driven by that information rather than kind of hand-coded MapReduce, most likely.
Okay. I think we have time for one more.
Okay.
Are you using this in production at Salesforce right now, then?
Yeah, we are. Things move along at a slightly slower pace than you might think at a big company like Salesforce. And it's for good reason. I mean, they're very careful about their data and security. I mean, trust is number one there, and it has to be. So our first use case is kind of, that's a little bit of a boring use case. It's for data archival, right? People want to be able to archive lots of data. And we need to, for compliance reasons, need to keep 5 years worth of data, right? So we have this in production now, a pilot for customers being able to archive their data through Phoenix into HBase so they can keep more of it and we can charge them less, essentially. Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.